Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
I would like to inform you, don't try to mug up these equations, okay, to use it in the exam. Needed, I will give you, but make sure what is the unit we are supposed to apply when we are substituting the values. For example, some books, they might have given 0.43 relative humidity minimum. Then RH minimum will be in ratio. If I have given 0.0043, then you have to use this RH minimum in percentage. N by N, this is also in hours and this is also in hours. This is a dimensionless. And similarly, when it is more than 2-4 decimals, it is in percentage. Otherwise, it will be in decimals. And wind speed, as I said, it is in meters per second. But normally, all meteorological station, they will give you the wind speed in kilometers per day or kilometers per hour. Okay. So, I would like to give you a small example. At an altitude of 35 degree south in the month of October. Right. So, then this is the data. Latitude is 35 degree and south hemisphere. Month is October. Go to this table. 35 degree. Right. South in the month of October, right? So it is 0.29. So P is 0.29. Average temperature, it is the average of minimum and maximum temperature. See, it's in general in India, we measure minimum temperature, maximum temperature, and dew point temperature. And if I need an average temperature, I just take the average of maximum and minimum. When it is an automatic weather station, temperature is measured at every time step. Then you can take all the average. That will be an average temperature measured. That will be different from this T max plus T minimum by 2. Okay. Now I am multiplying this ET with 5.2 mm. Then if I use only this, then I have to use this graph to find out what is the value of A and B, right? Instead of, I know all the values, I can substitute in these two equations, estimate this A and B. So, I will upload these notes to you. You can work it out, right? So, this is about temperature-based method. Then the second is radiation based method, where the major parameter used in all these methods are radiation values. Out of this radiation based method, Hargreaves method is most commonly used method. And Doornbos-Proot is the fellow who first developed this FAO book. It's a very important reference. I request everyone to go to FAO website and see that publication, FAO 24 and FAO 52, which talks about this evapotranspiration estimation. I'm not going to explain in detail about any of this radiation-based method. You read that one. But let us see this FAO modified Penman method, right? This is one of the combined method. As I said, it uses the temperature, radiation, wind speed, right? And the general formula used is like this, where ES minus EA is vapor pressure deficit, FU is our wind function, and RN is radiation function, and W is the weighting factor, and CP is the coefficient, which depends upon latitude, longitude, and all other parameters. And the estimation of each one value is a sub-formula, right? Like you can see that RN, which is difference between short wave radiation and long wave radiations, right? So it is 1 minus alpha. Alpha is called reflection factor, which is function of albedo. I'm just informing this for your information. To do this manually itself, needs a lot of time. That's why we used to write a code to estimate evapotranspiration, right? You can also try to estimate evapotranspiration using this small program to write, which was later developed, can be developed into a software, okay? And solar radiation is estimated using this formula, Ra, and then RNL, net long wave radiation, is function of temperature, actual vapor pressure, and N by N. So that's why this it's cumbersome. Fu is wind speed, where wind speed again in kilometer per day at 2 meters height. Blaney-Crittal method, you use it 2 meters, but unit is in meters per second. Here you use it in kilometers per day, because the regression equations, the coefficients developed by FAO use this unit, right? I just gave a comparative table which shows how many data points or what data is required and what parameters you can take it from your FAO publications. The bold line, right? Up to this, these are all measurements, right? Maximum temperature, minimum temperature, right? Relative humidity. This is DPT, is dew point temperature. Relative humidity, both maximum, minimum, wind speed, evaporation, E is latitude, N is actual sunshine hours. If you see temperature based method, they need only the temperature. And radiation based methods, I think I have not given. That is also, radiation is very important. And you see combination method, you need this many parameters to estimate, but it is more accurate. See, for example, why we have to spend this much is, this evapotranspiration is used to estimate the crop water requirement in the field level after multiplying. Suppose maximum it comes to our Indian condition varies from 4 mm per day to 7 mm per day, reference crop evapotranspiration. You can see what is there 1 mm, 2 mm difference. But when there is a difference of 1 mm per day, the area of irrigation is in hectares. Sometimes some of the reservoirs, it is in kilometer square. Then when you multiply this 1 mm per day with the hectares, which is a huge volume of water loss. So that is why people used to spend more time and more accurate method in estimating this reference crop evapotranspiration. The research, we have developed a reference crop evapotranspiration using radiation based method, temperature based method, as well as combined method. But combined method, you have seen, it's a cumbersome process. It's not possible for a field person to use it. So what we did, we converted this Blaney-Crittal method, or we have re-regression. We carried out a re-regression and the coefficients are modified such that with that equation will give you a evapotranspiration as if estimated using modified Penman method. It is published in Institution of Engineers. You can have a look of that, right? So this is another important hydrological processes, which is the major input for agricultural engineers. If they don't know how to estimate evapotranspiration or called crop water requirement, cannot do anything, right? Then the next important abstract are, you can say, loss is infiltration, right? Infiltration is just the process of water entering into the earth, that's all, okay? That is why you might have carried out in your second year the experiment, right? Infiltration using double ring infiltrometer. It is just the process of water entering into the soil. Once it enters into the ground, depending upon the geological condition, slope, current, aquifer condition, the water can move deep downwards, and we call that process as percolation, or it may take a horizontal move and we call that as seepage. I think you have done seepage analysis also using Elisha model. That is horizontal movement of water. or at least not deep percolation. So now we are going to see this infiltration, because for a water resources engineer, I'm not bothered whether water takes percolation path or seepage path. For a water resource engineer, the volume of water which has entered into the soil is not going to reach my reservoir. So that is why it is classified as a loss, but actually it is not a loss. This infiltration is the major input for groundwater hydrology. Groundwater hydrology is study of water below the earth, which is the major, this rainfall only reaches the groundwater. And like other hydrological processes, infiltration is also expressed in terms of mm per hour. I think you did an experiment on this. It's a big issue, right? And this is how the infiltration varies for different soil type, and the same soil type with different antecedent soil moisture condition, right? Antecedent soil moisture condition means the moisture content in the soil before you start your infiltration test. When you are doing the experiment, you will be locating your double ring infiltrometer at a new location. Suppose if you are carrying out in the same location what the previous batch did, then you will not have a curve like this. You will have only an horizontal curve, because your soil is already saturated. So the saturation reaches a constant value. So this variation, when the soil is dry and initially the infiltration rate is very high for any given soil type, right? Water enters into the soil at faster rate, and then it reaches an asymptotic constant value after a certain time period, and this constant value is called as basic infiltration rate. Then the infiltration rate at zeroth time step, that is called as maximum infiltration rate, right? Based on these two values, people have developed different equations to estimate this infiltration rate. Especially when I want to do a basin-wise study, then I need to estimate what should be the infiltration rate. Okay, and when this runoff happens, because infiltration, you might also seen several times when it is raining, suddenly water will not start flowing on the ground. Depending upon the soil moisture condition and the rainfall intensity, if your infiltration rate is more than your rainfall intensity, whatever the rain falls on the earth just simply goes into the earth. So the runoff or the flow of water from the earth surface starts only when the soil is completely saturated, or my rainfall intensity is more than the infiltration capacity, right? So infiltration process is affected by characteristics of the soil, surface entry, and also fluid characteristics. I think as usual, we measure this infiltration rate using a double ring infiltrometer. In the lab, you might have used two ring, but you will be measuring the depth of water which is entering only at inner ring. Then why I should use two ring? The purpose is here. Suppose if I use only one ring, then water will not directly enter into the soil. It may go into a lateral dispersion. To avoid that lateral dispersion only, we are using this double ring. The water which is at the center concentric ring will go exactly into the soil. The side one will go into the side soil. So we will be measuring only the infiltration rate. This is laboratory test, or if you want for a larger area, then you do a rainfall simulators. I am not going into the details of this. But when my area is very large, right? For example, several kilometers square, different soil type, right? Different antecedent soil moisture condition, different geological formation, then it's very difficult for me to incorporate this infiltration loss into my water budget. If I am doing a finite element or finite difference model, then each and every small grid I can give the value of infiltration rate. But when I am doing a lumped model, like only total rainfall, total runoff, total evaporation, total evapotranspiration, then I have to give the total infiltration. So then what happened? People used to develop an average value for infiltration loss, and that is called as infiltration indices. There are two infiltration indices. One is called as phi index, another one is called W index. Phi index is only a infiltration loss, where W index also considers also the initial loss, right? You remember depression storage and abstraction losses, right? Let us see how to estimate this, right? Phi index is, I said, average representation. If this is the hydrograph, the blue color is the hydrograph, then I take an average value, right, as the infiltration loss. How I can take this average value? I measure the rainfall and I measure the runoff. The difference is the loss. Okay, when I plot it in terms of hydrograph. Actually, the phi index infiltration loss is not like this. It will be like a curve. But to make the average for large river basin, phi index is equal to precipitation minus runoff divided by effective duration of rainfall excess. What is this effective duration of rainfall excess? It is not the duration of total rainfall. Effective duration of rainfall excess is the rainfall period during which runoff occurred. That means when infiltration rate is more than my, sorry, less than the rainfall, no runoff happens. So you have to remove that site, remove that time period, right? So W index, same one, but I am subtracting again with the initial abstract. Okay, so W index is equal to precipitation minus runoff minus initial abstract by effective duration of rainfall excess. Okay, phi index. Let us do this one small problem, right? Here, a storm with 10 centimeter precipitation produced a direct runoff of 5.8 centimeter. So total precipitation rainfall was 10 centimeter, runoff was 5.8 centimeter, and the rain has occurred for 8 hours. And this is the incremental rainfall in each hour, okay? Now I have to estimate the phi index. So what we do? First, phi index is equal to precipitation minus runoff by rainfall. So it says that 10 minus 5.8 by 8 hours. So 0.525 centimeter. The units are in centimeter per hour. But you see here the first hour rainfall and last hour rainfall. The rainfall itself is less than my loss or infiltration rate. That means runoff has not happened during first hour and last hour. Then what happens? I have to remove that 2 hours, then re-estimate. If I remove these 2 hours, what is the rainfall contributed for runoff? It is from second hour to seventh hour. So it is 10 centimeter minus 0.4 and minus 0.5, which is equal to 9.1 centimeter is the total rainfall contributed for a runoff of 5.8 centimeter with an effective duration of only 6 hours. So then my infiltration rate is 0.55 centimeters per hour. The difference looks very small, but as I said, when my loss is, my area is in hectares and kilometer square, then this loss will become huge quantity. So that your budget estimation will become more and more accurate. So it's an iterative process, and it is not necessary that first and last hour only infiltration rate will be more and rainfall is less. It may be in the middle also. So depending upon your observed rainfall, it may happen, right? But as usual, we engineers, you know, we want to develop several analytical models. I think you have done an experiment. So people have done this type of experiment. double ring infiltrometer at various soil type, at various antecedent soil moisture condition, and then they apply this geological geotechnical water balance, right, and derive equations. Either you might have seen that curve, it is an asymptotically decreasing with respect to time, so it is an exponential decay of function which is having an exponential decay of time. So several researchers have developed several formula. I am just giving you an example of only two, but out of all these things, Philip two-term model is very much useful in water quantity estimation using either finite difference or finite element model. But for our lumped models, simple Hartens model is more than sufficient. What is that lumped model? Right, Kostyakov model, he considered that infiltration rate at any time is exponential decay of time, right? But we don't know what is the value of AB as well as B. So to estimate this, you have to conduct experiment, then convert this into log values, right? Now this log value looks like a linear equation, which is function of time. Then the slope of, plot your values. You have observed F, take the log values. You have observed time. Plot the between these two values. The slope is B minus 1, and where it intercepts the x-axis, that means infiltration rate for zero time period, that is log AB. Take anti-log, you will get the value of AB. But out of several models, I feel that this Hartens model is good enough for a lumped water budget model. It says that the infiltration rate at any time is equal to FC. FC is nothing but the basic infiltration rate. I'm just going back to that infiltration curve, right? This value, where it becomes constant, this is the FC value. F naught is when you extend this graph and touches the x-axis, y-axis, that value is called as maximum infiltration or infiltration capacity. So if these two values can be estimated easily from my experimental values, F naught and FC, right? Then the F at any time period is FC plus F naught. That is the difference between, because the exponentially decaying curve is between this F naught and FC, e to the power of minus KT. Here the parameter unknown is K. To find out the value of K, take logarithm. You have measured the infiltration rate. After some time period, you got an asymptotic constant value, FC. Then for each value, you subtract this FC value, take log. You take natural logarithm or log E base. Fn, F minus FC log is equal to ln F naught minus FC minus KT, because it is e power minus KT. When you take log, it will become minus KT. Now you plot a graph between this value and the time, right? The slope is a negative slope because it is asymptotically reducing. The slope is the K value, and where it intercepts the x-axis or y-axis is the value of F naught minus FC. From where you can rework it out your F naught value also, right? So I'm just explaining you with an experimental data which you did in our hydraulics lab only, or some reference books also it is available. So this is the time start in minutes, and this is the infiltration rate. I'm not giving you how much volume you have estimated, then divide it by your area, all these things. Now I'm taking the value. So in Kostyakov model, what I did, first to plot the data, take log of F and log of T, plot in a natural logarithm. Otherwise, you can directly plot in a log-log sheet also, no problem, right? Then plot the slope of this curve. Slope of this curve is equal to B minus 1, and where it intercepts, for zero time period, what is the value of this? That will give you the value of log AB. Anti-log will give you AB value. So then the infiltration equation becomes like this, right? Then I did for our Hartan's model also. Plot the data from basic input. This is the constant value. You can draw, take the average, then subtract each value with the observed infiltration rate. Take natural logarithm and plot between time. And so the graph will look like this, right? And we can estimate the values of K. Okay, so this is a simple Hartan's infiltration capacity curve. You can now understand FC, this is F naught. So the F naught minus FC is varying only between my F naught and FC. Okay, so these are all some of the abstracts or some of the I am very skeptical about using this word loss. Actually, it is input, major input for other hydrological studies, but as a water resource engineer, it is not going to reach my evaporation. That's why our seniors might have referred this as a loss. Okay, so some of the self-study in this topic is solve all the problems given in this section. You can read the analytical models. I have told about heat energy exchange models or several other evaporation models as well as infiltration models, especially Philip two-term models. Okay, and this is the current research going on in this area. Easy method to find the initial loss, easy method to find the transpiration, methods to reduce reservoir evaporation, right? I think you can read how in Israel people are reducing the evaporation. That is one of the country which uses each and every drop of rainfall, right? You can take this, I will give you a class assignment for this. Then finding appropriate method to estimate the reference prop evapotranspiration. Okay, then people are using application of artificial intelligent techniques to predict the meteorological variables as well as reservoir evaporation, evapotranspiration, all these things. Okay, this is the current research in this area. If you have any questions, I'm ready to explain. If no questions, I think we'll ask too much in the name of abstracts, right? Let us start, or let us prepare ourselves for running as runoff. Because for a water resource engineer, runoff is the most important hydrological processes. Okay, so I will stop at this point today.